Hey guys, and welcome back. I'm Ted, your host on the lecture series. And for today's lecture, we are going to discuss the War of 1812. But now before we begin to our lecture proper on the War of 1812, I'd just like to do a quick recap on what we covered in our past three lectures. So in our past lectures, we discussed the agrarian society, how in the United States, due to the peculiar reasons for British underdeveloping their North American colonies, the North American colonies were overwhelmingly agrarian, and they posed no real commercial threat to Great Britain, and that many in the United States viewed the relative equality, the rough equality between great landowners, the great wealthy slave owners, and the great wealthy farmers and merchants in the American colonies, and the mass of small-time, small-holding farmers, the yeoman farmers, the rough equality there was viewed as being solely the product of agrarian, of their agrarian society. So they pushed that as the best way to preserve liberty. Chiefly, the Democratic Republicans, Madison and Jefferson, pushed that. We also examined how the great push westward, the needs of this agrarian society, the mechanism that was available for them to perpetuate this agrarian society, brought them into increasing conflict with natives who attempted to either adopt white European mannerisms and societies, such as the Cherokees and the Seneca, who attempted to merge their ancient traditional beliefs with this new system to sort of survive and find a place in the American Republic. And then we also saw natives like the Shawnee, who turned to resistance, who under Tecumseh began to formulate a plot to sort of bring it together various native groups to oppose through warfare, through violence, to oppose white encroachment on their lands. We also examined the Embargo Act and the debacle that the Embargo Act was. We saw that it was meant to sort of restrain Great Britain and France, to hurt them by depriving them of American agricultural goods. But the act hurt the Republic even more. It led to the financial ruin of merchants, bankers, farmers. Because France and Great Britain, they accounted for more than 50% of American foreign trade. As a matter of fact, the very bulk of American trade was directed towards Great Britain and France. Great Britain in particular was the early Republic's chief trading partner. And by refusing to trade with Great Britain, you see Jefferson simply caused more hurt, more damage to the Republic than seizures on the sea ever did. And lastly, we also saw the expansion of slavery, how the cotton gin fueled a push westward for cotton cultivation. Short staple cotton was now economically viable, so a lot of people rushed into the lands of what is now the Deep South, rushed into those lands to establish cotton plantations. Need fueled the creation and expansion of the domestic slave trade. With the suppression of the international slave trade by Great Britain in 1807, the domestic or internal slave trade developed to meet the need of those looking to establish plantations further west. And now with that being said, let's jump right into our lecture on the War of 1812. Now, the British had long practiced impressment on the high seas, that is, taking sailors off of other ships, labeling them deserters, and having them serve in the Royal Navy for undisclosed amounts of time. This was nothing new, but events in the early 1800s would cause an international breakdown in British and American relations. In July of 1807, the American merchant ship Caravan pulled into Macau, which was a Portuguese possession, for the intent and the purpose of trading with the Chinese. The Portuguese controlled Macau, and they functioned as middlemen between Westerners and the Chinese. It was very profitable for the Portuguese to do so. So the merchant ship Caravan pulled into Macau to do that, The HMS Diana, a British warship, pulled up next to the caravan and demanded permission to board her to search for Royal Navy deserters, rumored to be stowing away amongst the crew of the caravan. The caravan's captain, a man named Gilchrist, attempted to argue with the commanding officer of the Diana, but to no avail. As the commander of the Diana, with roughly 30 to 40 men armed with pistols and cutlasses, barreled past Gilchrist and took a handful of deserters back to the Diana. Now, Captain Gilchrist, at this point, he goes wild with anger, but his anger is pointless. There's nothing he can do. The British had won superior numbers and superior weapons. He could only fume at the indignation. He protests, but he is silenced along with his first officer. They're tied up, and his second officer is taken. Has a surety of American good behavior by the British back aboard the Diana. A little while later, about a month later, the schooner Topaz sailed into Macau to again conduct business with the Portuguese in exchanging their goods for Chinese goods. And again, the Diana pulled up beside the Topaz and again attempted to board the Topaz. Now, the Topaz was captained by a man named Nichols, and Nichols fired upon the British boarding party, wounding an officer from the Diana. The British, in response, swarmed the Topaz, shot down Captain Nichols, and took possession of the Topaz and her cargo, charging them with piracy on the high seas. These incidents happened because the United States was helpless. And they were helplessly caught up in the struggle between France and Great Britain. Remember, Jefferson had gutted the Navy. He had reduced the Navy, so you don't have a Navy. And even the Navy that existed under the Federalists was pitifully small. He had no Navy to contest the British or the French, either separately or in tandem. He had no Navy to contest them at all. These were the two superpowers of Western Europe at the time. Jefferson's response, since he could not militarily fight them, since he had no navy, and he would not incur the expense of funding a navy, his solution was the Embargo Act, which, as we discussed earlier, hurt the United States far greater than it ever did the British or the French. Now, after James Madison was elected president in the November election of 1808, the embargo, as everyone understood it, was as good as dead. The embargo not only wrecked American commerce, but it almost toppled the Democratic Republican Party. In 1808, Madison took full party leadership from the disillusioned Jefferson and faced a very vigorous campaign led by Charles Coatsworth Pinckney of South Carolina, who ran almost solely on a platform of repealing the embargo. Madison won the election, but Pinckney swept New England, and the Federalists picked up 23 seats in Congress. The Democratic-Republican majority in Congress proved really to be just as worrisome to Madison as the Federalist contingent. In 1808 and 1810, a number of uncooperative Federalists were elected to the Congress, who were really on a mission. And the Federalist Party at this point, without the leadership of Hamilton, didn't really have great leadership, but they did have an agenda, and their agenda was to simply pull down Madison and to inflict a mortal wound to really just gut the ambitions of the Democratic Republican Party. The Federalists elected to Congress. They were also aided by some really just wild Democratic Republicans from the Western states, who were convinced that the Democratic Republican leadership, i.e. Madison, had not done enough to bring the British in line. Now, that brings us to a group known as the Warhawks. And the Warhawks were really just this faction of Democratic Republican politicians who demanded war, really, from the president. They demanded war from him. Henry Clay was one of these new national politicians from the West. And he agitated immediately. As soon as he got into Congress, he agitated immediately for war with Great Britain. Clay was a card-carrying party man, and he was devoted to the Democratic-Republican ideas. The really quote-unquote Jeffersonian agrarian vision for the Republic. And he even made sure that the First National Bank was not rechartered when the charter came up for renewal. He blamed the British for the continued trouble with the natives in the West. Clay was the more prominent of these new Western men who advocated for war with Great Britain. The, as mentioned before, Warhawks. And the Warhawks boasted that the National Army and the state militias could easily bring the British to heel by invading Canada. They believed that if Canada was taken, that it could be used as a hostage to ensure British good behavior on the seas, and maybe, and they also hinted that maybe good Republican virtue might rub off on the Canadians, and they would then turn to eagerly join the American Republic. And this was an American romantic notion that harkened back to Montgomery's failed invasion of Canada during the Revolutionary War. Now, Madison preferred diplomacy and restraint to these difficulties. After all, Madison had been an active participant in the drama of Jefferson's presidency and also the drama of the 1790s under Adams and Washington. He very clearly understood, more than these young bucks, more than these newcomers, he more clearly understood what was at stake in challenging Great Britain and France. He very clearly understood that there was a monumental fight going on between the two, and that if one of them decided to throw a pinky towards the United States, then there's no telling what type of damage, what type of havoc that pinky could do to the United States. So Madison's hand was really forced when alleged correspondence between John Henry and Sir James Craig, the British governor of Upper Canada, when plans or a plot similar to the Burr Conspiracy were uncovered, papers were bought by James Madison that implied that the British were attempting to conspire with the New Englanders to wrangle New England out of the Republic. John Henry was an Irishman from New York, and he had pretty much taken it upon himself to do all of this work. He found that the New Englanders were not very supportive of his plan, and that the British were not really supportive of his actions either. So he decided to sell his supposed correspondent to the highest bidder, who happened to be James Monroe, the Secretary of State for James Madison. Now, Monroe bought it for $50,000, which was an extremely large sum of money back then. Madison forwarded the purported correspondence between Craig and Sir James Craig and John Henry regarding siphoning off Massachusetts and the rest of New England from the Republic. With this information, the Warhawks moved to push President Madison to confront the British more vigorously. They pushed for outright war. The correspondence authenticity has always been called into question and is still questioned now. But the British, for the Warhawks, had gone too far. They conspired with natives, they impressed American sailors on the sea, and now they were attempting to tear the nation asunder. So in 1812, the Warhawks at the Democratic-Republican caucus made it clear that they would only support Madison if he went to war with Great Britain over the repeated insults suffered by the United States at the hands of Great Britain. So it was that Madison very reluctantly asked Congress for a declaration of war, with the Federalists in Congress tried to hold up for as long as possible. But the war bill was eventually passed by the Democratic-Republican-led Senate on June 7th of 1812. Now, the United States was very ill-prepared to wage war with anybody in 1812, especially to wage war against Great Britain, one of the global superpowers of the 19th century. 12 years of Democratic-Republican rule has seen the national budget and the national tax revenue drop to about 1/20th of Great Britain's. The United States Army was only 75,000 men strong, and they were commanded by a mix of aged Revolutionary War veterans and a lot of inexperienced newcomers. The United States Navy was in even worse shape, thanks again to Jefferson's reduction. It only consisted of 16 ships, and these ships were 7 frigates, and the rest were gunboats and sloops. Now, the Royal Navy, in contrast, had over 115 frigates, and over 120 of those massive ships of the line. Those ships of the line were moving aquatic tanks. They simply took down what was in front of them, no questions asked. Excuse me. So the Royal Navy had this this incredible advantage on sea. In terms of manpower, and then also in terms of just aquatic vessels, in terms of warships. But this fact really didn't trouble the war hawks, who were the main proponents of this war. They knew that the bulk of British forces would be elsewhere fighting Napoleonic France, while Canada would be vulnerable, being only protected by the highly disorganized garrisons of 57,000 regulars stationed to defend her. Canada, in their mind, was ripe for the picking. Thus, the War of 1812 began, and the war was immediately found to be more difficult to prosecute than the quasi-war had been, and resulted in the humiliation of the war hawks. Now, Madison's Secretary of War, William Eustace, drew up a 3-prong invasion plan for Canada. Now, the plan could only be described as extremely optimistic. The first prong, attacking from the west, will be commanded by General William Hull. Now, Hull, with 20,000 regulars, mainly infantrymen, would invade the southern tip of Upper Canada from Fort Detroit. They will be joined by 26,000 regulars and 36,000, I meant 2,600 regulars and 3,600 New York militiamen under Stephen Van Rensselear. Now, they would move into Canada, crossing the Niagara River. Now, this larger force would then complete the conquest of Upper Canada. Now, General Henry Dearborn, would lead an attack from Plattsburg, New York, and he would attack Montreal and Lower Canada. Now, Hull's progress was exceedingly laborious. He had great difficulty moving his forces from Ohio to Detroit. And again, there is no internal improvement. There's no road. There's no road leading from Ohio, from the Ohio Territory, to Fort Detroit. There's simply a thick tanglement of woods, wood and shrubland. There's no canal. There's nothing to really ease the movement of settlers, let alone an army, a field army. So it took him a very long time, and he only reached Fort Detroit with great difficulty and a great exertion of labor. Now, once he had moved his forces there, he lost his nerve in North and Lower Canada. Once he had crossed from Fort Detroit, he lost his nerve, and he fell back to Fort Detroit, where a combined force of British regulars, Canadian militiamen, and Native Americans swept down upon him and forced his surrender. Thus ended his campaign. Van Rensselaer crossed Niagara and swept away all opposition to him, but he was really unable to do much beyond that because of a dispute between him and the ranking officer in command of the regulars. Van Rensselaer was a New York militiaman, and the ranking officer of the regulars was a man named Smith. Now, Smith refused to take orders from a militiaman and stood his troops down. Van Rensselaer was forced to retreat when British reinforcements began to appear. And Smith, for his part, later he attempted to launch his own invasion of Upper Canada, only to find that the militiamen would not follow his orders and went home. And Dearborn, for his part, changed his battle plan completely, moving west along the St. Lawrence River, forsaking an attack on Montreal. And he faced the same problem with the militiamen, who argued that it was a violation of their constitutional rights for him to order them onto Canadian soil. Those were, in effect, the dismal blunders, the very dismal campaign of 1812. They paled or were offset in comparison with the American affairs, the American war affairs of 1813. William Henry Harrison, the hero of Tippecanoe, the man who defeated Tecumseh's brother and destroyed Prophetstown, was given command of forces in the Western Territories, and he was really charged with repairing all the damage done by Hull. Now, Harrison sent a force to recapture Detroit, but that force was defeated by a British coalition, again comprised of regulars, Canadian militiamen, and Native allies. That force was defeated and then massacred by the Natives. Aaron Burr's old friend, James Wilkinson, the same Wilkinson who lost his nerve during the Burr plot, he now appears on the scene. And Wilkinson leads an invasion of Upper Canada, and he managed to capture the town of York. But Wilkinson's men, they went on a rampage afterwards, looting and burning the town. And really just hindered any sort of advantage he had in fully prosecuting the war. the Navy fared way better. Under the command of Lieutenant Oliver Perry, Perry created a small flotilla of gunboats and small armed vessels and sought out and defeated the British Lake Erie Squadron in a battle that raged all day. Now, Perry accomplished in one day what the Army had roughly failed to do from the beginning of the war. By capturing Lake Erie, he made Upper Canada indefensible. The British were forced to evacuate Fort Detroit and Lower Canada to William Henry Harrison, who eagerly swept in. Tecumseh, for his part, was amongst the British. He was still living in exile amongst the British in Canada. And he managed to persuade the British command to make one last stand on the Thames River in what is now Ontario, Canada. But during the battle, Harrison's riflemen, they simply broke the lines of the British and their native allies. And Tecumseh himself was shot down trying to rally the men to reform their lines and to rejoin battle. After the battle, Tecumseh's body was desecrated, was defiled by the militiamen, who cut strips of flesh from his body to use as razor stripes. Unfortunately, the United States Army found no way to exploit the gains they had made in 1814. And really, the rest of the campaign of 1813 sort of dies away. And it picks back up in 1814 when Jacob Brown, and Jacob Brown was a Quaker, but he was a military man. He's curiously referred to as the Fighting Quaker. Jacob Brown leads new campaigns in 1814. The Fighting Quaker crossed the Niagara River again and soundly defeated British forces at Chippewa. He then went on to engage the British forces in Canada at Lundy's Lane, which was a bitter and a bloody standstill of a battle. It ended in a draw. Jacob Brown had really brought the fight to the British, but his losses were staggering, and he was obliged to really call off his campaign. He was obliged to end his campaign because of the losses. Now, in 1814, the British really took initiative. The British could only react and respond to American advances and American offensive. But in 1814, they took the initiative from the Americans, and they launched their own three-prong invasion counterattack. 11,000 troops freed from serving from Napoleon's first fall from power. And this is another sort of important factor. The Americans had expected the Napoleonic Wars to continue to rage. They had expected Great Britain's forces. They had expected to achieve rather quick and swift victories against Great Britain. From between 1812 and 1813, they had not expected their military to be repeatedly embarrassed and repeatedly rebuffed by the British colonial defenses. With the end of the wars in Europe, Great Britain's armies and navy were now free to be turned loose on the American Republic. A great fear at the time, the British Navy, the British Army, vastly outstripped and had way more experience and confidence than their American counterparts. So these 11,000 troops freed from service in Europe by Napoleon's fall from power were sent to Canada, and they were sent to Montreal, and they were moved south from Montreal and on to New York City. This would sort of be a rehash of Burgoyne's march, coming down from Canada, marching through New York and cutting off and dividing the colony, cutting the colonies off into segments and into more manageable chunks. Secondly, a joint force under Admiral James Cockburn would raid the American Atlantic coast. And thirdly, General Edward Pakenham would capture New Orleans and rampage throughout the Western territories, the territories along the Mississippi River and Ohio Rivers of the United States. Cockburn struck first, sailing boldly into the Chesapeake, and meeting no resistance, he landed his forces at will and burned several towns, including the national capital of Washington. As a matter of fact, Dolly Madison, the wife of President James Madison, very famously rescued a portion of Washington that hung in the original White House, and just barely escaped the British advance. In fact, when the British under General Ross reached Washington, they found that the president president and Congress had recently been alerted to the danger and had recently fled. And that night, General Ross and his high command ate the dinner intended for the president. They ate Madison's dinner that night. They destroyed the city. They burnt everything. They burnt the original White House. They burnt the original government buildings. And sort of interestingly and really mockingly, they held a mock Congress to debate whether or not to burn the city to the ground. And Ross, with his senior officers and his junior officers, debated whether or not to burn Washington. A very interesting episode. In the end, they decided to burn Washington. They burnt it to the ground, left it a smoldering heap. After the burning of Washington, they moved on to Baltimore. They were intended to destroy the city of Baltimore, to burn that city as well. But they met stiff resistance from Fort Mchenry that defended Baltimore. And in the end, they were forced to sort of pull off, to disengage their attack and to simply continue harrying and harassing other more easily assaultable coastal areas. Now, the land invasion under George Prevost that was descending from Plattsburg cut a wide swath, a wide path through upstate New York. But at Plattsburg, they were defeated by Brigadier General and Alexander Macomb and Commodore Theodore McDonough. In a joint force effort that forced them to retreat back to Canada, that forced them to recross the Niagara and to simply play defensive ball. Now, the major surprise of the war was the performance of the United States Navy. Aside from Perry and McDonough's little fleets, no one expected the American Navy to do much against the Royal Navy. Indeed, the United States Navy never attempted to challenge the British squadrons, nor did they even attempt to break the blockade that was strangling the American Atlantic ports. The Americans, however, did accrue an amazing string of victories in single combat actions against the Royal Navy. The USS Constitution, for example, fought and captured the HMS Guerrier off of Halifax in August of 1812. Shortly after that, she fought and sank the HMS Guava. Java. She fought the HMS Java. The sloop USS Hornet. The USS Hornet captured the sloop HMS Peacock. String of verbal mishaps. The frigate USS United States captured and defeated and captured the HMS Macedonian. The USS Essex, of course, captured the HMS Alert and later will go on to attack and capture 15 other British trade vessels in the South Pacific before being cornered off the coast of Chile and pounded into pieces in 1814. So there were a number of individual victories for the United States Navy, for United States naval vessels in single combat against British ships, but not really a contemplation ever of attacking full-on squadrons in the Atlantic or the Pacific, or even really attempted to break off the blockade, to fight off the blockade that was strangling the United States lifeline, that is seaborne trade. And Andrew Jackson comes fully to prominence on the national scene during the War of 1812. The United States enjoyed the only consistent military army successes, land successes enjoyed by the United States were those enjoyed in the South, in the territory of Mississippi and in the state of Georgia, where Tecumseh, before his death, had aroused the warrior elite of the Creek Nation to wage war against the United States. Roughly 2,000 Red Stick Creeks, and they're called Red Sticks because of the red sticks given to them by Tecumseh to symbolize the uprising, to symbolize the resistance against white settler encroachment. The Red Sticks raided settlements and garrisons along the Alabama River, and they massacred white defenders at Fort Mims. The War Department could not spare any regulars for a campaign against the Creeks. They were far too busy trying to react to the British counterattack and also trying to find men to funnel in for their own offensives. What they did do, they authorized the Major General of the Tennessee Militia, a former congressman and backcountry judge named Andrew Jackson, to summon volunteers to deal with the Red Stick Creeks. Jackson, with 2,000 militiamen under his command, crushed the Red Stick Creeks at the Battle of Horseshoe Bend in 1814. He then forced the Creeks to sign a very unequal treaty, yielding more than 22 million acres of their land to the United States. Jackson then pursued the renegade Red Sticks into the Spanish territory of Florida in 1814. He moved to Pensacola, occupied it, and he claimed it for the United States. And he did this all without justification or authorization from Congress. He had no authority from Congress to do any of that stuff. But these actions begin the pattern of Jackson's national profile and his character. Andrew Jackson was a guy who simply did things because Andrew Jackson liked it. You can sort of take the Chuck Norris jokes and really just apply them to Andrew Jackson. Jackson fell back to New Orleans and began to fortify the approaches to New Orleans when he got word of Pakenham's ensuing attack. And on January 8th, 1815, he won a truly spectacular victory against the British. He threw back Pakenham's host while inflicting over 2,000 casualties while suffering only 13 of his own. It was a truly great victory. Now, the few victories won by the United States had depleted the treasury. Recruitment had to be suspended very early in the war effort, and the government was operating by borrowing money. The ongoing blockade was choking off seaborne commerce, the financial vitality of the nation was seriously in jeopardy, seriously in doubt. Now, the Napoleonic Wars had come to an end, and with the fall of Napoleon at Leipzig, Great Britain could now transfer all of her energy to prosecuting the war against the United States at exactly the same moment that war weariness was at an all-time high in the United States. Now, the British were suffering their own war weariness. They had been at war since the turn of the century. They had no desire to continue war, and they began to offer peace negotiations with the United States. Now, while all of this was going on, a very important convention was being held in held in New England by the New Englanders, and this convention is known as the Hartford Convention of 1814. And in New England, the Federalists were in dire straits. New England totally backed the Federalists against the Democratic Republicans. They dominated local politics. No region had been hurt more by the British blockade than the mercantilists and the seaborne and those who made their fortunes, who made their daily livings and their fortune from seaborne commerce more than the New Englanders. No region had less reason to trust Madison and the Democratic Republicans. The Federalist top-heavy Massachusetts legislature passed a peace resolution and urged New Englanders to do the same. At the Hartford Convention, New Englanders organized a convention and sneeringly referred to the War of 1812 as Mr. Madison's War. And the 22 delegates from all over the New England states called for amendments to the Constitution to rein in the wild powers of Mr. Madison, to bring Mr. Madison to heel. And they even threatened to hold a second convention, a separate convention, to be held in Boston, should their proposal be rejected.